Hey everyone, this is Manly Badass Hero, and welcome back to A Bomb Called Darkipt. Previously on A Bomb Called Darkipt, we went through the first run of the game. Now we're on the quest to the true route to try and see if we can save Monica. Would he never come to understand the room he was in? No, that wasn't the case. Neil felt nauseous standing here. And the place that revealed the things she kept in the depths of her heart that she pretended to overlook. He wanted to get out. Then again, despite the lack of evidence he fought, if he went beyond this point, there would be a chance of saving her. So this whole gimmick is you gotta go up 50 floors. You have a certain time limit on each floor. Let's try it here. You have to go up all 50. That's actually pretty redundant. There's a time limit. If it runs out, you go all the way back to the beginning. If you die, you go all the way back to the beginning. And so basically, every once in a while, you gotta come back, reset your time, and cash in. And during this, there are things that want to kill you. By touching this, you can escape from this place. You would do well to remember that. Your presentiments are not mistaken. You may be clinging to the past, but she is on her way to a splendidly cheerful road, regardless. And after that, she will eventually land, won't she? And you will just be alone, as you are. But go in deep, and a door will open for you. So it's kind of like Persona and Tartarus, with the kind of blue butterflies too. You gotta go through and just basically walk to the end within your time allotted. Even for a third-rate researcher, I was an idiot for getting caught in that scam. When we came to the city, above all, I felt my pretension was necessary. And what's more, when I first saw the people of this town, covering their eyes beneath their hats. I found them pitiful, clinging to something to the point of not being able to see through the lie. I was a researcher, but I made it my goal to cooperate with others. They all gave up and left, unawares. It was a fresh new idea hatched in order to triumph over all of them. In the end, we lost our nerve, until we came to a point where we could not stop ourselves. Nevertheless, simply handing weapons over to those people simply would not do, don't you think? See, the bomb-carrying enemies, and the way the city looks, it makes me really think this is all just symbolism. Like this is one of those kind of hipster games that's just describing the process of war and making the human bomb. I mean, the nuclear bomb, rather. And that thing has a cooldown time, so if you use it too long to try to detect them, it's like in recharge mode. I'm gonna show really quickly what happens if you don't kill one. As soon as I find one that's actually... there's one. Alright, this is what happens if you decide not to kill it. I kind of like the kind of artsy poeticness of this kind of 50-floor run. And the music is, you know, real nice. Even if it's just a classical song that's very famous, it suits pretty well in this section. And I think the way the bombs carrying Monica's kill you is kind of romantic. Because when they drop the bomb, it looks like they're kind of coming in to embrace you afterwards. And that kind of makes me wonder if there's something more to this story. Wouldn't it be the first story to use that kind of twist? Gunning down my wife. Who's symbolic for both being a bomb of my life and a literal bomb. I don't quite know if that is an actual warning. Or is that just like 1 minute has passed? So we meet again. I'll keep you company until we reach the top. Goodbye, rabbit. On to the next floor real quick. You notice he also shoots out the legs like he does in the opening. Anyway, let's check in. There's a lot of rabbits in this series. I guess they're kind of a mascot for Brown Sugar. Anyway, if there's no storyline in the floor, at this point, I'll just, like, skip over it in the editing, so you don't have to kind of watch too many just useless running scenes. Although, like I said, it's kind of nice and it works well with the music from a gameplay perspective, but watching, probably not so much. I think that the bell going dong means a minute has passed. When time expires, it tolls immediately and without fail. But I mean, it never rings when, say, a 1.5-minute halfway point passes. Who's the girl on floor zero? That person is the one that supervises this place. She shows the way to the misguided. She approaches people she wishes to see reach the top. These are by their ice cream. Picture Patty Mr.Miles liked ice cream. And I think the characters from A Fake Story will always hang around like an ice cream cafe or something like that. I think the monsters come up each floor, one at a time. You'll have to find out what that means for yourself. I don't know. This is the 30th floor. You must be tired, huh? But you best stay sharp, or you might stray from your goal. Thanks for the help, Rabbit. Your, vague dialogue's very appreciative. Why do you think everyone wants to redo things? Isn't the present far more precious than the past? I'm kidding. Hang on to your ideals as you see fit. The top is up ahead. When you reach the top, ready your gun. You said you want to do things over. You won't change your mind about that. This tower, there is a great influence residing within. On the other hand, there are also people that do not wind up so misled by the tower. The next floor will be the last. Don't forget to have your gun ready. So Rabbit was the girl who gave me the gun in the first place. Also looks a lot like one of those dimensional warping agents from A Fake Story in Patty Mr.Miles. I felt that tinge of accomplishment, as if I had ran a marathon. One floor down than another, I desperately made my way to the top of the tower. I had been speaking with someone as I struggled to get here, but I wasn't able to commit that someone to my memory. But therein too, I have an uneasy feeling about the ideals that I think exists beyond this point. Since who knows when, I've been turning into a prisoner in this world, This is the last stage. This place I can see. So pretty it sucks me in. I have to kill myself. If that's true. Truly a stairway to heaven. I think that's a city, isn't it? Looks kinda like it. God, this is so trippy. I'm tempted to watch this to the end. Echo. It's like summing up an entire life. This world is really taunting, isn't it? Ah. In a vague story, they talked about some war, and that kind of ruined the world. I think this really is a kind of symbolic story for war or something. Enough of that. No, something's changed. The door should be visible to you by now. What did you say? You mean I have to start over? That's up to you. Just who are you? Why are you here? You've come to a place now from which you cannot go back to reality. That's that. I don't understand. I've noticed that my head is beginning twisted, but these fantasies and illusions mean nothing. What happened before cannot be undone. But if it's happening all over again, this isn't right. It's not here. She isn't here. But where? Where is she? He's going for all the different worlds and doors. Monica. Monica!
Actually, if you remember, one of the doors did lead to that road. It's also where one of the endings occurred.
That's enough.
I'm to explode at this point, for I am a human bomb. That's not right. You're Monica. You're not a bomb, but rather my one and only wife. Don't do this anymore. We can start over from here. Neil, I'm so sorry. I've discovered a fascinating world. A place where we don't need to lie.
You might recognize this area also. This was actually the door that led them to the second act of A Vague Story, if I remember correctly. And now, I will lead you to the breeding stables. I'll entrust your rearing to Rona. Oh, were you having sweet dreams? You may think that form of yours is a little ugly feeling for now, but it is the form of the people of the future. Sure, it takes time, but you won't break apart if we piece you together bit by bit. Rest assured, I am not a liar. I'll be leaving you in good hands. Let me give you your first injection. Over here now. The world is just for the two of us. We've decided to live our lives here, undisturbed. Everyone is so noisy, so we'll kill you. You're harmful. We'll kill you too.
So in the end, in the big twist, this was a prequel to A Vague Story. Showing how these monsters came to be. A kind of both romantic and a twisted end for both of them. Very fitting for this universe, which tends to kind of suck. So that's it for A Game Called Darkipt, a kind of almost twisted fairy tale, much more so than A Vague Story in Patty and Mr. Miles. Patty and Mr. Miles was an unfinished game, which I say is too bad because it was a really good game for what it was already there. But that one was kind of a deconstruction of RPGs and kind of Animal Crossing games in general. While A Vague Story was kind of a little bit more of an artsy thing. And this one, like I said, it's a little bit more of a twisted fairy tale. It shows you how those weird killer beings came to be in A Vague Story. Because if you remember, if you read the books in that, they claim that they didn't know where they came from. Although, the organization obviously had a better idea than they did. And by that point, they've been breeding and kind of going mad. And they're everywhere now. But it kind of explains how their form is a bit of a romantically twisted thing. Where Monica and Darkipt are together forever,
but in a form of a kind of misshapen creature. Either way, like the other games, is this a good game? Certainly twisted and depressing, which is too bad. I don't mean too bad in like a, you know, it's a bad game sense, but too bad for our main characters. Because at least Patty and the other characters had some closure to their ends. I suppose it's not too bad for them. I mean, they do stay together, but I don't know, it doesn't feel satisfying. If we kind of link the stories of these games together, we know there was some kind of great world war that devastated the world. One of the towns, I believe, in a vague story that you could visit for the doors was the town that ate the kind of addictive vegetable in Patty and Mr. Miles first. And that town was already in ruins by the time of a vague story, so Patty and Mr. Miles may come before the others chronologically. But we know there was a war, we know there's people who can do magic, and we know there's people who can kind of slide through dimensions. We know from this game that these countries, people are running away from the wars, going to towns, and they wanted to make more weapons. And as you saw, Neil didn't want to do that. He convinced them to build this weird bridge to nowhere thing, which I guess was a way for them to maybe escape or evacuate. And eventually they, you know, rejected this concept and they said, no, we need weapons and bombs instead. So like I said before, I think this game is a bit anti-war in its message, and just the floaty Monica carrying bomb thing is kind of representative of that, really. I think it kind of is obvious. But in the end, this would put a vague story, I think, in the furthest chronologically, although it kind of exists outside of a timeline, I think. Like I said, Patty with Miles must be first. Either way, the main thing is this universe really sucks, and no one has a happy ending, and everyone's just a real prick and really cold-blooded. Anyway, so thank you all for watching me play A Bomb Called Darkipt. I'll see you guys later. Take it easy.